Yeah.
Well, thank you for that introduction, and thank you all for coming tonight. Happy Organic Week. As Kathy mentioned, I am a nutritionist here at the store, and I also work in the standards department. So I'm going to be diving into some of that work today, and we're going to be chatting about organic standards, trying to understand that standard a little better, understand that organic logo that you see on a lot of our products. So tonight we're going to get into the specific principles of the organic system, as well as the benefits of organic. It's always good to remind ourselves why we care about the organic standard. And then we're gonna get a little bit into the compliance side of things. So a lot of people don't think about what's involved in maintaining that standard, and there is a lot involved. So we're gonna chat about that. And then I'm gonna talk about some other logos, mainly the non-GMO project logo, so that butterfly that you might see on our products downstairs, just as another option for when you're purchasing. So we're gonna go through some of the labels that you're seeing, try to deconstruct them a little bit. And then we're gonna end off discussing how to stay on budget when we're buying organic foods, because I know that's a big concern for a lot of people. So what is organic? The organic system is an agricultural system that sustains the health of soils, ecosystems, and people. So it's really a holistic approach. In terms of history, organic farming is a lot like what our ancestors used to do, right? And then around the Second World War, in the sort of 1940s, 50s, industrial agriculture started up. And because of this, this new system that was growing, organic practices and standards were sort of developed to distinguish between the two. So post-World War II, there was all those synthetic pesticides being used. And as we started getting into the 50s and 60s, there were groups of concerned individuals that were starting to talk about the interdependence between our health, or the health of our bodies, the quality of our food, the quality of our soil, right? And as they started discussing these things, they started to develop organic standards. Oops. So you can see here, the International Foundation for Organic Agricultural Movements, IFOM, was developed in 1972. And then in 1991, the first standard came out, and that was the EU standard. As usual, Europe sort of got it figured out before we do. Then the United States came up with their standard in 2002. And then several years later, in 2009, Canada came up with our standard. And we learned a lot from what the US had done. So all of these standards have key principles in common. They are focused on maintaining soil fertility, promoting biological diversity, keeping away from prohibited substances, so pesticides, herbicides, and caring for livestock, so thinking about what their natural behaviors are, supporting those behaviors, preventative care. Oh, why is it moving? Okay. And of course, prohibiting genetic engineering or genetically modified organisms. So organic, in order to promote soil health, animal welfare, biodiversity, water quality, and transparency in the food system, needs to prohibit a lot of things. So those things include synthetic pesticides, fungicides, fossil fuel fertilizers, sewage sludge, synthetic growth hormones, the use of antibiotics in livestock, ionizing radiation, genetically modified organisms, and nanotechnology. Add on to that synthetic biology, which we're going to be talking about later. I'm sorry, I don't know why it's automatically doing that. Not super tech savvy. All right. So the organic system really emphasizes proactive management practices to prevent issues. So it's really a proactive approach. And what that means when you're on the farm is many things. You might be introducing beneficial bugs instead of using insecticides. You might be utilizing crop rotation. I'm gonna try and fix that. Using crop rotation to disrupt weed cycles, using cover crops, something like rye is often used to maintain soil health. So cover crops get turned in at the end of the season instead of pulled out and sold. They get turned in, and that creates a really nutrient dense soil. So these are some examples of what organic farmers do, some strategies that they use. So they might be using compost instead of, to promote plant growth and to feed the soil, using fertilizers that are allowed in the organic system, and there are some. To reduce pests, they might be using plant compounds, something like neem oil, which is a natural alternative, or beneficial insects and birds. Farmers might set up birdhouses so that birds are welcome in that area and are doing, you know, their work for them. So they're getting in there and they're grabbing those bugs off the potato plant or whatever. And then they might set up physical traps and other things instead of, again, just going in and spraying everything, right? I mentioned the cover crops. Another way to manage weeds is rotating crops, mulching, hand weeding. So a lot of organic farmers are really getting in the dirt and doing the hard physical labor. And then when it comes to livestock and preventing disease and encouraging growth, there's a lot of strategies used. First and foremost, organic feed is used. So all the feed those animals are eating must be organic certified. And then they are given access to outdoors. Sometimes there's really neat setups where, you know, they might put the pigs in an allocated area, you know, give them free rein, they're gonna chomp up all those weeds, then they'll move the pigs over to another area, and that's doing some of the work for the farmers. So there's lots of really, really cool strategies that organic farmers use. So how are organic products better for us, right? We're always saying that, why and how? First and foremost, we're avoiding pesticides when we're buying organic. That's huge. We're also avoiding the use of antibiotics, chemical fertilizers, growth hormones. So we're reducing our exposure to these environmental chemicals, which of course, you know, things like organophosphates, which are linked to all sorts of health issues, cancer being one of them. I wanted to just kind of jump aside for a second and point out this really interesting study that we helped with back in 2013. So a couple of researchers came to the store and worked with us. We funded them, we gave them all sorts of groceries, and what they did, they were testing to see whether eating organic really does reduce the exposure to harmful chemicals as compared to a conventional diet. So they chose 9 kids from 5 families around the GTA, and they did a fairly simple test. They changed their diet over the course of 12 days, and they got them to pee in a whole bunch of cups. And they tracked their urine output and what was in that urine to prove that organic really does mean less pesticides processed by the body. So what they found was exactly that. So days 1 to 3, they were on their conventional diet, eating, you know, whatever they usually do. And their pesticide metabolite levels in urine were quite high. So that's the left side of the chart. And then days 4 to 8, they had an entirely organic diet. So that's absolutely everything from, you know, ketchup, mustard, anything that they were eating was organic. And they found that those pesticide levels went down quite dramatically. And then days 9 to 12, they went back to the conventional diet. And again, that chart sweeps up. So it's a fairly simple study, and obviously not done on a huge group, but it does just point to the fact that when we eat conventional foods that are sprayed with pesticides, our body has to metabolize those pesticides. They gotta go somewhere, right? So we are processing all of that when we eat conventional food. How many, just as a point of interest, how many pesticides do you think are sprayed on a conventional apple, the average conventional apple?
40.
Oh, close. That guess was 40. Any other guesses? It's a little bit higher. It's about 48 different types of pesticides that can potentially be sprayed on a conventional apple. So it's a serious business. And when all those pesticides are being sprayed, who's spraying them, right? Who's exposed to that every day? The farmers. So organic is better for farmers as well, right? The people that are in the fields doing all that hard work, their families, they're being exposed to these really toxic chemicals. So the interesting thing about the organic system is not only are you reducing that exposure, but there's also a lot of social well-being goals that are sort of incorporated in that system. So you know, offering fair income to workers, safe and dignified working conditions, supporting organic communities as well. So you look at food security, the diversity of land use. There's studies that have been done looking into, for example, the average diet of farmers farming organically, and they're finding in certain, especially in developing countries, that those diets are a lot more diversified. So instead of monocropping and, you know, only planting soy all day every day, they're planting a diverse group of crops because it, you know, they all sort of interact together and you're working in that holistic system. And because of that, they have access to a much more diverse diet. So that's kind of an interesting benefit as well. Organic is better for animals as well. So you're looking at access to outdoors that they probably don't get in a conventional system. For ruminants, you're getting access to pasture, right? So those cows are getting to eat grass. And obviously in Canada, not all year round, but during, you know, those warmer months, they are getting access to that grass, access to sunlight, fresh air, respect for their natural behaviors. All these things are really important, not just, you know, from an ethical standpoint, but also in terms of the nutrient density of the products that those animals are creating. So I'm sure you guys have seen videos or photos of organic eggs versus conventional eggs, you know, that bright, bright yellow or orange yolk. Or studies done on organic meat having higher levels of some of the really great essential fatty acids because they're getting to eat grass, right? So happy animal means happy human eating that really nutrient-dense food. So better for us, better for animals, better for those farmers, and better for the planet. The organic system is really about thinking sustainably, thinking about the earth, the quality of the soil. One of the big things, one of the big problems we're hearing about is carbon dioxide, right, in the atmosphere. And healthy soil naturally retains that CO2 instead of releasing it back into the atmosphere. So that's one really amazing benefit of farming organically. This is gonna drive me nuts. So a study from Rodale estimates that if all the crop and pasture land around the world were converted to organic agriculture, it would sequester 100% of our annual CO2 emissions. So huge impact in thinking about the quality of soil and in protecting our planet. So you want to think about soil, air, water, biodiversity, so all those insects, birds, bees, everything around that organic land is also being thought about, right, in that organic system. And they all work together in this sort of an integrated food web, and they all become more resilient as a result of that. So we walk the talk, or however that saying goes here at the Carrot. Our organic commitment, it really is true. We were the first store in Ontario to certify to the organic Canadian Organic Standard. Many of you, I'm sure, shop in the store. You know that our produce department is entirely organic, except for a few wild items. You know that our juice bar and our deli are certified organic. And that takes a lot of work. We're going to get into those standards and compliance work today. And so just appreciating that, you know, we are taking the time to not just, you know, okay, it's the middle of winter, we'll bring in something conventional just to fill the shelf. That's not happening. In the produce section, everything has to be organic all the time. Same with bulk as well, or labeled as other. And in the last 10 years, we've donated over $1 million to organic farms, organizations, educational events. So we're really trying to support this system, not just in our store, but also in our community. And members of our store also serve on boards. So boards of the Canadian Organic Trade Association, the Canadian Organic Growers, the Organic Council of Ontario. We have involvement in the Non-GMO Project, which we're gonna talk about. So we really are trying to get in there and support the system in any way that we can. And we're finding that customers wanna support it too. So people are buying organic for a lot of different reasons, but the top reasons are the transparency, sustainability, and of course the avoidance of those really contentious ingredients, namely genetically modified ingredients. So transparency, sustainability, avoidance, we're going to talk about how all of those things are ensured in that standard. So the organic market in Canada is worth over $4 billion. It's the fourth largest market of its kind in the world. And in Canada, we have 4,000 certified organic farms, and that continues to grow.
Can you go over that again?
The 4,000 certified organic farms?
Fourth largest.
So fourth largest organic market. So when we look at dollars being spent on organic products, we're the fourth largest market in the world. So we're behind the US, Germany, and France. So meaning that we really are putting our dollars into this system.
Canada is.
Yeah. So this information, some of this information I pulled from another presentation that I'm developing for the Guelph Organic Conference in January. And it's really nice to look at the economic impact of the organic system as well, because as we know, a lot of policymakers are thinking from that perspective a lot of the time, right? What's that?
What's going to happen in Germany because they bought Monsanto?
We'll see. That's going to be a hot topic, I think, in the next few months, the Bayer-Monsanto merger, for sure. So we are the fourth largest market worldwide, and over half, so 58% of Canadians are purchasing organic products every week, and more importantly, 98% of those shoppers are expecting to increase their spending in organic fruits and vegetables over the next year. So people really are committing to this system. So this is all coming from the Canadian Organic Trade Association. So they did a massive report. They do one every year. And so they really focus on that economic angle, proving, you know, they'll go province to province. So, you know, the largest market is in BC and then Ontario. They'll talk about the diversity of shoppers. So who is buying organic? So that's a really interesting thing. It's not just high and middle income anymore. It's sort of across the board. Everyone is starting to support this system. Yeah. So pretty trustworthy numbers because it's coming from the Organic Trade Association. Yeah. All right. So we know organic is great. We know people are buying into this system. Now I want to look at what this standard really means and dig into that a little bit. So the Canadian Organic Standard was created again in 2009, and it includes food, drink, livestock feed, plants, and all of these are treated both provincially within Canada and then internationally as well. What it doesn't include is fertilizers, pet food, cosmetics, textiles, and NHPs. That means supplements, basically, so natural health products. These products that aren't included, so you might say, yeah, but my, you know, mascara is certified organic. And it can be, and it can be sold as organic because it might be certified by someone else, so the EU or the States. But we don't, it's not within the scope of our particular Canadian organic standard, or also known as CORE, Canadian Organic Regime. So the standard is incredibly long, incredibly detailed. There's a whole lot in there. It's very dense, but it breaks down into three main documents.
Can I just ask, on the last slide, you said that aqua fish.
Mm-hmm. Aquaculture.
Not under the scope.
Right, not under the scope. Mainly because you so there are certain elements that you can control, the processing, right? If it's a farmed fish, you might be able to control that, but we can't control the ocean to the same degree, right? So it's there are other strategies to monitoring and regulating that particular industry.
So in Canada, there's no certified
organic farmed
fish?
I don't believe so. There might be farmed, but not the ocean fish. It's a little bit of a sticky. The majority of it is regulated more by things like Sea Choice, and you know, you'll see other labels like that. I don't want to say definitively that none of it is certified organic, but it's technically not under the scope of the Canadian organic regime. Yeah.
Unless it's fertilizers, it's not included. what do you mean, fertilizers that you, one would buy, or fertilizers that's put on the actual food?
So fertilizers that one would buy. So those aren't necessarily being given the logo.
Oh, I see.
But within the system, absolutely, what's being put on the soil plants, in the plants is being monitored. So that's actually a good link into this. So you have your product regulations, your standards, and then really importantly, you have your permitted substances list. So fertilizers would have to be made up of ingredients that meet that standard,
yes.
that are on that permitted substance list. Yeah. So there are, as I said, a ton of documents, a ton of standards, and they're related to sort of different elements of the system. So one thing that the standards are related to is crops. So this will get into rules about crop rotation, as I was talking about cover cropping, buffer zones. So that's a really big one, right? Knowing that your organic farm isn't right next to, you know, Bob who's spraying Roundup every day, you know, and then the wind hits and it's going onto your organic apples or whatever.
Yeah, I know an organic farmer.
Yeah.
And right across, he's got like a GM crop.
Yeah.
The wind blows that way. Is that
right.
The difference? Like if the wind is, he says the wind is blowing.
Well, the wind's going to change, but he would have to go through with his inspectors if he is truly certified organic.
Exactly.
Right,
yeah.
So he's not certified.
Yeah.
He might be doing a lot of amazing organic practices,
right.
But in order to be certified by the standard, there are rules about buffer zones. I don't know all the details of, you know, exactly how many meters, kilometers, whatever, but there are rules, and the inspectors certainly would be looking into that when they go and visit these farms.
Yes.
Yeah. And then you've got the standards I was sort of alluding to earlier around livestock, so things like accessing outdoors, having access to grass to graze on. Cages are not allowed for poultry, rabbits or piglets, and poultry must have access to outdoors at some point. So there are a lot of reasons why that organic meat is a little bit more pricey, right? I want to keep all this in mind as we're talking about this stuff. And then you've got standards related to the processing. So you've got the growing, the cultivating of all these things, but then you also need to transport them. You need to package them, and you need to maintain them in the store, right? So we, for example, at the Big Carrot, in our organic produce department, can't, you know, throw raid around because some ants have come in July, right? You have to think about all of those things, and pest control is a really big one at the, you know, final end, at the store end of this system. So there are specific rules about what kind of pest control you can use, what kind of packaging you can use, how these items are being transported so that their integrity is maintained throughout. Okay, so that's a whole lot of things to think about, a whole lot of standards. Who's monitoring that? How do we trust that is actually happening? So the Canadian Food Inspection Agency is overseeing the regime, and what they're doing is they are accrediting certification bodies. So then those certification bodies are going to visit the farm, are going to visit, you know, the pasture, are going to visit the processing plant, or coming to our store and doing an inspection here. So this is a really trustworthy system. There's a lot of regulation, inspection, and that's continuous. So people can't sort of lapse over time because they are annually inspected, and when they, you know, when they have that logo on their packaging, on their products, that really means something, and they have to maintain that quality.
What kind of accountability for having enough inspectors actually
to
monitor?
Right.
How can you guarantee that?
So.
Or that they don't look the other way, kind of, with certain things.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they wouldn't. It's not just anybody that can sign up and go, okay, I'm an inspector now, right? These are accredited bodies. So there's the process of actually accrediting them to be a qualified inspector and certifier, right? And then in terms of having enough people, that's an interesting question because it is a growing market. So I think that there is concern about that, having enough inspectors to keep up with the new demand and production. But there are a lot of processes that have to happen. So a really good example, and I didn't really appreciate this fully until I started working in our standards department, but we are held accountable to any detail that that inspector wants to come in and ask us about. So, we bring in organic and conventional almond butter, and we sell both of those in our bulk, we sell the organic in our bulk department, right, in bulk. We have to have a paper trail, and we have to be able to say, okay, 50 kilos of organic almond butter was ordered, 50 kilos of organic almond butter was sold, right? We have to prove that at no point in the process did somebody switch out, the almond butter for a conventional bucket, just as one example. And that might go for anything that we sell in both organic and conventional options. And inspectors can come in and ask about anything, right? So there are a lot of details and a lot of sort of ways that it's guaranteed to be, people make mistakes, things happen, but I think when you set up a stringent enough process, right, it guarantees a lot less room for error, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Who inspects the inspectors?
Yeah. That's a good question, and I don't know, but ultimately the Canadian, the CFIA is the ultimate boss, really. So they are responsible for following up with the inspectors. But that is that's a bit of a tricky question for me to answer.
But how do you know, I have a friend of mine that told me, because she does this, makeup company thing, and they also have supplements and stuff, and she said they had, this is what you have to be aware of, they had, these bodies that certified, said that they actually did, then they had to find somebody else, because they actually found out that they were certifying them organic, but they weren't organic. So how do you know?
Well, I think, on the one hand, you could say, how do you know anything, right? I mean, we can be super skeptical. Yeah, you can be super skeptical about a lot of things. But what you can trust is the logo. And the logo means that a lot of effort and time and, checklists have been processed through. And we're going to get into some of that. But ultimately, I think it's an important distinction to know the label versus just a claim that something is organic, so we're going to get into some of that.
It's not a claim, it was another, a body that certifies, just like you're saying.
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, you'd have to look into what that certifying body is, who they were accredited by.
I'm just asking.
Yeah, no, fair enough. Yeah?
Sometimes I see organic produce, and let's say I've seen organic oranges from Israel, and there's stuff from Mexico, even China, they're organic.
Mm-hmm.
Is it certified in the country of origin, or is it certified here? And if it's certified in the country of origin, are those standards consistent with ours?
That's a really excellent question. So we do have equivalency agreements with certain countries. So with the United States, we have an equivalency agreement, meaning that something with the USDA label is equivalent to our Canadian standard, and vice versa. EU, same thing. So it would depend on the product, and you would be able to see on that product who certified them. So some of the products downstairs, you'll see the green leaf. It's like a green square with a little sort of white dotted leaf. That's the EU organic standard. And you might see that and only that. You might not see the Canadian symbol on that particular, bottle of olive oil or whatever. And that would tell you that that was certified by that European standard as opposed to our Canadian standard. Yeah?
I wanted to ask you, is there any strategies to improve, like we were talking before, there's a lot of stuff that isn't, can't be certified organic yet, like fish. We don't have parma.
Mm-hmm.
Here for sardines, for example, from Scotland or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
Is there any plans, to raise the bar more so that we are more of an organic country and we can compete with the other countries that are up there? Is there anything that's going to improve that over time? I know that a lot of big corporations now are agreeing not to
right.
Use GMOs in their food, for example.
Yeah.
But that's the big corporation. But I mean, in Canada.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's a fantastic question. I think it would take a lot of, it's not an easy question to unpack.
Yeah.
I think there are.
Or do you see any signs back?
Well, I think we all do. I mean, yeah. Things like the fact that the market is growing, right? People are investing their dollars and they're trusting in that logo. Yeah. They're wanting to invest in that logo or the non-GMO project logo. So, I mean, we vote with our dollars, right? And that makes an impact higher up the chain, you know, with political representatives. We have at the Carrot all the time, I'm sure a lot of you have signed petitions, you know, stop GM alfalfa, all these sorts of things, right? So I think there is a growing social movement. Whether there's sort of like a specific plan in place, I mean, that, I wouldn't be able to answer that personally.
You're right, but I think it's up to people.
I think it is up to people.
Yeah, GMO.
Absolutely. And so part of that is knowing the difference to make a difference, right?
Yeah.
We use that phrase a lot around the office. Know the difference to make a difference.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's education is huge, right? Unpacking all these things like we're doing tonight, understanding what that logo means, mm-hmm. why we want to support it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the more people are educated and the more they can make, you know, conscious
and demand, like in
consumer
restaurants, for example, is this GMO?
Exactly.
Regardless of how silly that might sound to the waiters.
Yep.
Say it. Yeah.
And these things, you know, these things evolve over time, right? So, you know, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, nobody was talking about whether the fries were gluten-free, you know?
Yeah.
This is now a common question in restaurants, right? So these things grow as movements, and I do feel that we are in that movement right now. I mean, you look at the US, you look at all this kerfuffle over the Dark Act, all these things going on in the States.
Yeah.
So, you know, it is very much in public consciousness right now. So I would say that, yes, we are moving towards something. We are trying to prioritize. The Dark Act is a labeling act that just got passed in the United States. So they're calling it the Dark Act because they're not requiring companies to explicitly label something as containing genetically modified ingredients. What they're doing is saying, basically, you can find out more information here and giving people a code or a phone number. So they're going to have to take their smartphone and scan something or call a number. So they're just making it a little bit easier for companies to sort of hide the fact that they are making products with GM ingredients. So this just got passed in July, and it was a big deal because Vermont had done so well creating an amazing labeling act, and the Dark Act sort of came in and, like, essentially muted the Vermont Act. Yeah. So,
I saw I picked up a jar of jam. It said organic.
Mm-hmm.
And it had all these things that organic.
Yeah.
And then when it got to pectin, it just said natural fruit pectin.
Right.
And I thought to myself, like, that comes from a fruit, but it could be the apple now, the genetically.
Yeah, well, not quite yet, but I see what you're saying, though.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And so it could say organic, but not be totally organic. But if it says organic, shouldn't it be that it's not GMO'd?
Right.
Or does it have to say that?
Such a good question. Mm-hmm. Stay tuned. We're about to get there, all right? So that's exactly what tonight is about, right? Is understanding when you're in the aisle and you're looking at this jam and you're going like, what does this mean, right? That's what we're going to get into tonight. So I'll just keep on going and then we'll get to that stuff. So I really like this image. I think this is something to keep in mind, that the organic system is a long and winding road. So, you know, ultimately we're talking about soil quality, right? Health and fertility of soil. We start there. We start with our organic seeds. Those seeds are grown in a very particular way, right? So we are avoiding the chemical pesticides and insecticides. We are using cover cropping. We're doing all of these things to grow that crop. A lot of the crops grown are, of course, to feed animals, right? So in order to raise our cows organically, we have to produce the seed, the feed that we are giving those cows, right? So that's the first part of this road. Then these lovely happy cows are making delicious milk and cheese and other, you know, other products. Chickens are producing eggs, all these things. So then this milk has to get processed in an organic certified facility, right? Then it's distributed. That distribution has to be inspected and regulated. Then it comes into stores, right? So somewhere like the Big Carrot might repackage. We might get a giant block of, you know, Parmesan and cut it up into smaller pieces. And then we're putting that label back on there if we are a certified processor, right? So that's another step in the process. And then we chatted about the things like pest control. So once that organic apple has, you know, gone from seed all the way through this process and ends up at the store, it also has to be protected at that end, right? So in the store, that apple needs to be, if it's in a regular grocery store, needs to be segregated from the conventional, right? Here, our entire produce section is organic, so there's no commingling happening, no contamination happening, but we do need to be concerned about things like, okay, somebody's gonna come in and, you know, wipe off that plastic shield. Well, they're not just using Windex, right? They're using something from the permitted substance list in the organic standard. So there's a ton of detail at every process, every point in this process, right? So I think it's a really nice image to keep in mind. And as I mentioned, so things like cheese, or you know, we might cut up carrots and cucumbers and package them for your convenience, right? And if we're gonna stick the Canada Organic label on there, then we have to follow all of those rules, right? And that inspector can come in and ask us how we're doing all of these things. The coffee is up there because our juice bar is certified organic. So we don't get to just run out of milk and not, you know, use conventional milk. We have to maintain all of those. You know, our almond milk is organic almond milk, all that stuff. All right? And the Big Carrot, as I mentioned, was the first retailer in Ontario to become certified to the Canada Organic Standard. So as a reminder, that is the logo. And you might also see EcoCert on some of your products as one of the certifiers as well. So,
oh boy.
Right? Well, this is what happens though. You go to the store, you pick up a label, and it's making a million and one claims, right? This is a, you know, a fair trade product. This product is local. This product is, you know, Rainforest Alliance certified. It's somehow, you know, animal welfare.
So how is almond milk certified humane?
Well, that might not be on an almond milk, right? But this is just, like, not every single one of these labels is on every single product. But it just goes to show that there's a lot of greenwashing happening. Like, there's a lot of symbols that we're seeing. And it's really important to distinguish between them and understand what these logos mean.
All those are good though, I think, right?
They're all great for their own reasons, yeah. But they're not all regulated, right? Oh. The organic standard is federally regulated, right? This is a really key thing to keep in mind, right? So that traceability, that trustworthiness is represented by that logo.
Ones are the non-GMO.
Yeah. So this is the EU organic, right? This is the Canadian one. This is the US.
Fair trade is good.
Fair trade is excellent. They're all good.
Yeah.
You know.
What about non-GMO? Is that organic or not?
We're gonna get into that. You guys are like so on top of it, you're getting there before I am. So a couple things to keep in mind. Now we're going to start getting into some images of products and sort of getting into the nitty gritty of what a label means. So there are some differences legally between us and the United States. So in the US, you can call something 100% organic. That is not permitted here in Canada. If something is 95% or above organic, then it can have that logo on it. And as I mentioned, so this is the US logo, that's the Canadian one. They are considered equivalent. We do have an equivalency agreement.
Why can't the Canada have 90%?
Yeah.
Is it that it's not possible in Canada?
That is, that's just illegal. That's a decision that I guess we have made, our decision makers have made. Maybe because they don't want to mislead people.
It's misleading if you don't know it's 100% organic.
Yeah.
The Because that means that our government says, well, nothing's going to grow 100% because we're going to put something in the soil, you know?
Well, no, and we're going to get, hang on 1 minute and we're going to get into that. So between 70-95% organic, you can make the claim that it is a certain percentage. So it might say, this is an 80% organic product. Contains 80% organic ingredients, right? The wording is just slightly different in the States. And then for both countries, if it is less than 70% organic, they can list it in the ingredient list. So you might see something, you know, a pizza that says organic tomatoes, you know, organic wheat, and then a whole bunch of other ingredients that don't say organic. But you know that those two things in that product are. So we go into the store, we get into the grocery aisle, we have to choose between 6 million different cereals. How do we know that this product is organic? Is it? Right. So we see the Canada Organic label. How do we know that it was third party certified?
It's one of those little things down there.
That's right. This product is third party certified organic by, and here's where the traceability accountability comes in, by QAI, Quality Assurance International. And there's a whole, several, QAI is one of the bigger ones, but there are several certifying bodies. So traceability is huge in this system. So I could, if I wanted to, right, I could take that cereal box, I could read that label, look into, well, who's QAI? Well, who's certifying and accrediting QAI as, you know, as an inspector, right? So they are being transparent at every point of the process. So that's really why it's a trustworthy system. It's not just a claim made on a box that you can't follow up on, right? They're telling you this logo was put on this box because QAI certified that it met all of the standards of that logo represents.
That's how you know it's 100% organic.
95% or higher. And stay tuned.
Okay.
So here's another really good example. This one's in French. But so if you picked up this pizza and you read 70%, you saw organic pizza, right? Is it certified organic?
70%.
Right. So why isn't it certified organic?
So it's less than
90 bucks. And there is
no
logo.
So only if it's 95% and above, it's certified organic? I did not know that.
So you came here for a reason. There you go. You learned something.
I have no idea.
So here's the key for you guys, right? So we do have a slight margin to work within here. And that is because there are certain ingredients in products that may not be available organically, right? And so there are rules about that.
Does that necessarily mean they're GMO or non-GMO or this and that?
So no, that's a really excellent point because this other 5% can't just be made up of anything, all right? So this 5%, it can get a little bit confusing.
Can I give you an ingredient maybe so they can understand? Like, I know when I get stuff like this, or even when you go down, you get it from your deli.
Yeah.
Sea salt.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because that
one
you can't certify.
You can't certify salt.
Right.
Or something like citric acid, or, you know. But what we do in those instances is we trace back and we say, that company has to prove a couple things. They have to prove that product is not available organically. So that happens to us in our deli, right? So if we, you know, we want to make something and, oh man, it's going to be so expensive to get organic, you know, maple syrup or whatever. That's a bad example. But some ingredient, we would have to call around and prove that isn't available organically in order to use it in our, so the sea salt, right? There's proof that we cannot find that organic certified sea salt, right? So that's a really good example of how the standard is so stringent. So another company, restaurant or, you know, deli, whatever, might say, yeah, our stuff is organic, but is it certified organic? Or is it like when things are in season, when things are cost effective, we'll buy organic. And then, you know, when the tomatoes get pricey, we'll switch to the conventional, right? If it's a certified department or restaurant or store or whatever, you cannot just make that switch.
It's what I'm understanding that the U.S. that says 100% organic, we're saying it's not possible and they're lying on that label?
Depends on the product, right? Because if you're making that claim about something that only contains, you know, is a soup that only contains cream, tomato, parsley, that could be 100% organic, right?
But why in Canada would you? This is the problem I'm having. Like,
yeah.
Why isn't it possible here as well as that?
It's not that it's not possible. It's just that we don't.
So we're not requiring something that they might.
It's not that the requirements are different. It's just the label claims are different. Yeah.
So I don't understand why they can't say 100% organic.
We are always err on the way of caution.
I think, yeah. It's legal.
Yeah.
It's legal mumble jumble. So it's not to say that no product is 100% organic. We have lots of 100% organic products. It's just that product would use the logo as opposed to the 100% organic like wording on their label.
Can I ask this? Let's say you have something
it's
like
a weird
pizza with 70% organic ingredients.
Yeah.
Can they still have if they can have the non-GMO project label on that?
Yes, if all the ingredients
all the
are non-GMO.
Because not necessarily organic, but doesn't that mean that they're not GMO?
Correct. Right? And we're going to get into the non-GMO project label. So it is just really important to keep in mind that when something has that logo, you might have a little sticking point. You might have an ingredient like pectin or salt or something that that isn't technically organic, but it's because it's because the label is on there, that logo is on there, that company has to prove that whatever that little 5% is still didn't use sewage sludge, still wasn't irradiated, still is non-GMO. Like, all those standards are still met. It's just not quite as stringent as the other ingredients.
Company,
right. So they have the same... Try not too hung up on this first one. These two are equivalent. Same rules about the 95% and 5%. Okay? This is just a wording thing that we've decided in Canada. We don't want companies to be able to slap 100% organic on the front of a box. Okay? But in terms of quality of this logo and what this means, it means it's at least 95%. So a ton of products that have this logo on it are 100% organic. But then there are others that might have some weird little, you know, citric acid or whatever, but it would not be GMO. It would not. Yeah, you can't just throw anything in that 5%. Yeah.
That's good. That's clarifying. Really.
Yeah. When you get something like this, it's 72%.
Yeah.
So what's the other 28%? Right. So, that other 28%. If we're gonna put that organic wording on there. Again, no GMO, no sewage sludge, no, right? So this is really maintaining the integrity of what organic means. So, you know, somebody doesn't get to say, this is organic cereal because they've used one organic ingredient, you know, out of 10, right? So this company is saying, like, we've made a commitment to this. We haven't quite met the standards of the logo, but we're getting there, kind of thing. You guys, honestly, you're getting there 2 seconds before I am, because we're just about to talk about that. You know, it's a really interesting thing, because provincially, so this is a federally regulated system, but it gets confusing because we don't have specific provincial rules necessarily, or they might differ. So which one of these honeys is organic? Based on what you're seeing right here. Okay, so right now there's no way to know, right? We see the word organic on both those labels. Right? What does that mean? What does organic beekeeping mean, right? Labels are confusing. So we do a little bit more research. We flip that jar around.
Oh, wow.
So which one was organic?
Oh, that one.
Exactly. You see the logo on the Hockley honey. Does that mean that this is conventional?
No.
No.
No, it doesn't.
Not necessarily.
Sure.
So provincially, you can make a claim that something is organic. You can use that word on the label as long as it's provincially sold. Second that starts moving elsewhere, you gotta watch those claims. So some companies, they're really local, they're making a granola and they're selling it, you know, just in Muskoka or whatever, and they can put that word organic on their label and not legally get in trouble until they start going elsewhere, and then they can't start making these claims unless they can back them up. This is where knowing your supplier, knowing your farm, knowing your producer, right, is really important, because this is a fantastic honey. I eat this honey all the time, and the owner of this company is doing a heck of a lot. So organic beekeeping is not a false claim.
No.
But she is not specifically certified to the standard.
What kind of bees does she use? Mason?
I don't know. I don't know.
But
she, what they are doing is ensuring that, or trying their best to ensure that the plants that the bees are going and pollinating are organic, right? So it might be that the beehives are in a location where, you know, it's all organic land or whatever, but it costs money, and there's a lot of, as we're finding out, there's a lot of processes involved in getting that logo, that real seal, right? So a company might choose not to do that. They might say, here's what we are doing, but they're not necessarily certified organic.
Considering the bees are, all the flowers are organic, so it's just a matter of if the farm is organic or not, you can get the claim or not.
So, honey
bees
is.
They're not gonna go grab honey from a sugar and make honey out of it. They're gonna go to the pollen.
Yes. So, honey is one of the hardest things. This is why Hockley Valley is quite unique in having that logo on their honey, because honey is really hard to certify, because bees go far and we can't necessarily control exactly where those bees are going. What happens is you get certain areas where they know, okay, bees aren't gonna go past this radius. Right? Like, they're not going to fly to New Zealand. They're going to stay, you know, within the province, right? And if they happen to be harvesting this honey in an area that is large enough, like all the surrounding area is organic, then the certifiers can come in and say, okay, we feel confident that these bees are feeding off of
95%.
Or more.
Higher.
No, it could be higher.
Yeah.
Man, you guys are really sticking on that. All right. So, it all comes down, again, to that logo. So, oversight and transparency. When you see that logo, you know that all those processes have been checked along the way, right? That there are very stringent rules, and that those are protected by that logo.
Are the new products
also 95%? Their standard is very similar in terms of what's allowable. Yeah. So the thing is that you're not just certifying, you know, an apple, a pear, a tomato. You're certifying these products that might have 10, 12, 20 ingredients in them, right? And the more processed food, you know, we're very much into processed food now, but we want these labels on that food, right? Like that granola that might have, you know, 15 ingredients in it. So that's where it gets tricky, and that's why they set up rules about, okay, well, prove to us, you know, that this pectin you used did not come from a source that was genetically modified or whatever, the citric acid was processed in such and such way, and there would be paper trails, right, that company would have to prove. So what we do in our store is we trust this label. If something is labeled as non-GMO or doesn't have a label to support any claims, we have a non-GMO policy in our store, right? So we are looking into, okay, well, what's your source for that citric acid? What's your source for that sugar, right? We're looking into those things. So we are doing our best to have a bit of oversight here within the store as well, because not every single product we carry is certified organic. Not every single product we carry is certified to the non-GMO project, right? So there are sometimes gaps, And so we follow up with those companies, and that's a big part of what the standards committee does. So I wanted to, I just wanted to bring to attention to your attention the natural claim.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But this is a big one, right? So you look at consumer studies, and you know, like 60%, 60 odd percent of people associate natural with non-GMO. They are trusting a lot in that word, right? So I think this is a really great example. I ate so many of these as a kid. Camping trips, I love the peanut butter ones. So good, right? As a mom, you're shopping, your kids are screaming at you, you're just looking for a healthy snack, you know, for the kids after lunch or at school, and you see that box, doesn't it look great? Oats and honey, those are healthy things, 100% natural, whole grain oats, right? But then you flip the box around and you look at the ingredient list. Sugar, canola oil, brown sugar syrup, right? So are these things GMO?
Yes.
Probably. Especially when it's labeled just sugar and not cane sugar or something. So highly likely that the sugar is GMO. Highly likely that the canola oil is GMO. Over 90, I think it's 95% of the canola we grow here is GMO, right? So the interesting thing about this particular product, this particular company, is that they are they're actually in a lawsuit right now. I think it's still going. So the Organic Consumers Association, Moms Across America and Beyond Pesticides, they've filed against General Mills, who owns Nature Valley, for deceptive labeling. And they were specifically caught up on the whole grain 100% oats, the 100% whole grain oats, because they were saying this is really deceptive. Saying that they're 100% natural oats implies that there are no pesticides involved, no GMO involved. And what they were finding was that there were traces of glyphosate, which is in Roundup, which is sprayed on oats, right? Or can be sprayed on oats. So that's an interesting example of all, you know, claims that you see on products all the time, and understanding that they don't necessarily mean anything, right? So that's when you go back to those logos, right? Really?
Oh God!
Yeah, oh, yeah, definitely.
If you watch the washing, you can see jugs.
Yeah.
Canola.
Yeah, that's. And have you asked them whether it's genetically modified canola oil?
We know it is.
Yeah, but asking the question is still important, because then that server goes to their boss. Hey, a customer asked me today, is our canola oil GMO? What does that mean? Why is that important, right? And then that conversation happens. And that's really important.
So when you say something can be a certified organic and still be that, like rice, for example, you know, I'm afraid of rice now because I get to hear about arsenic in just about all rice, but it could be grown organically, but can it still have something bad in it that's not a pesticide or a herbicide?
Right. Good question. The sad reality is we live in a pretty toxic world now, right? So the organic rice is going to be grown according, if it's certified organic, according to all of those principles, right? So you're hoping that and you're trusting that that soil is a lot more healthy than your average conventional soil. That doesn't mean it doesn't contain arsenic, because arsenic is naturally occurring in soils. So, I mean, and also, how many lollipops do you see that are certified organic, right? I mean, organic doesn't necessarily mean that it's, you know, there is organic sugar, there is organic fat and, you know, salt, and there are a lot of processed foods that are certified organic. So, there's not sort of this halo around the organic label saying, like, this is never going to do any harm to you ever, right? I mean, we still have to make our decisions individually, understanding our bodies, understanding the consequences of what we eat. But what it does do is it tells you, okay, well, that sugar was grown in such and such way, or that rice was grown, you know, in an area where the farmers are paying attention to the ecosystem, paying attention to the quality of the earth, to the quality of the, you know, the habitat, and all of these other things. So so it's still a system worth investing in. But when it comes down to, is this healthy for me, you know, that's a whole other series of questions.
Yeah.
So that's a really tricky one, because companies get into It's like fragrance in cosmetics, where companies don't always have to divulge what that is because they say, well, that's proprietary information. So flavor is a tricky one, but if it's in a product like this, I wouldn't feel that confident about it. If it's in an organic product, it means that it has met those organic standards. So somebody has had to divulge the information somewhere down the line to say, this is what's in our flavor, so that they know that it comes from. Yeah, that's why you don't buy Nature Valley granola bars.
And if the TPP is passed, that litigation would never be allowed.
What? Yeah.
The TPP is passed, that litigation wouldn't be happening. Yeah. You know.
Yeah. Okay, so before we get too depressed, guys, let's get into this amazing butterfly logo, because it does represent some pretty awesome things. So, the butterfly represents the Non-GMO Project, which was established in 2007. Interestingly, the Big Carrot was one of the founders of this project. So the Big Carrot and the National Grocery Company in Berkeley, California started this whole initiative up in 2007. And it is the only North American body that is consensus-based standard for GMO avoidance. Independent non-GMO verification, so separate from the organic system, separate from everybody else. They are doing their own testing and verification, and a third-party label. So it's a voluntary market-based strategy for preserving and building a non-GMO food supply. But it's important to remember that this label is all about GMO avoidance. It has a laser focus, so it is only concerned with genetic modification. This is a big deal. Mm-hmm. This is a big, huge deal. But we just have to keep that in mind. Exactly. Not necessarily. It might be. So just to remind you, it sounds like this room is pretty well versed in GMOs. But just to remind you that genetically modified organisms are plants or animals created using genetic engineering from bacteria, viruses, plants, or animals. The really key point here, which distinguishes it from all the crazy stuff happening with wheat or all the varieties of apples, is that this is specifically forcing DNA from one species into a different species. So something that would not naturally connect. So naturally, you're not gonna find a gene from a fish in a tomato, right? That's not naturally gonna occur. Whereas you might find, you know, apple A and apple B come together to create apple C, right? So this genetic modification cannot occur in nature or traditional breeding, so traditional farming methods. And what results is an unstable combination of plant, animal, bacterial, and viral genes. So where are we seeing genetic modification? Huge in these four, these are the four crops grown in Canada: canola, corn, soybean, and sugar beet. Now think about, like, now, I want to say 80, 90% of any conventional grocery store, right? You walk through all those aisles, what's in there? Corn products, canola products, soy product. Might be soy protein, it might be corn starch, it might be canola oil, it might be baking soda, baking powder made from corn, genetically modified corn.
There's a good list right by the washroom.
Mm-hmm. Everything affecting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where is most of the corn going? Into cows, right? So,
yeah.
So those are the ones that we grow in Canada, those four. We do import some cottonseed oil, papaya, squash, and milk products.
What else about papaya? Recently, yeah. Store itself. I used to buy it because, you know, it was in Hawaii, and it the numbers starting with four.
Mm-hmm. I used to be able to answer that with more confidence, but I believe it changed. I can't answer this with confidence, but I want to say that at some point they kind of like ran out of numbers, so they started adding, like, doing the eight as well, because I used to think that meant it was GM.
Yeah,
but I can't say that with confidence anymore.
Five
Yeah. I'd have to look into that because I remember a while back that topic came up. And there were some claims that like, well, no, it's not. It's because of this and this. So I'm not as confident in answering that question. I'm sorry. I can't say with total certainty that the 8 means genetic modification. Okay, so these are the GM foods that are not, that are in, you know, may have been or are currently in production, like in labs trying to, you know, figure it out. But aren't actually on the market. Now, since this presentation or this slide was made, potatoes have been approved. Yeah, and the salmon, as Kathy was mentioning, and some non-browning apples as well. So these are genetically modified. So at some point, tomatoes, they started coming up with GM tomatoes and GM rice and GM flax, but none of these actually made it to the market. Yeah, except for the tomatoes, which were briefly sold, but never in Canada.
I know the Wendy's said they do GMO free pig or whatever.
Right.
Because
of the concerns about the enviro pig. But here's where it gets a bit depressing, right? That alfalfa has been sold and planted. The GM salmon is in production. Apple, same thing, right? So this is a reality.
The alfalfa I heard was important for a growing organic.
So alfalfa is a really huge deal because alfalfa is huge in animal feed, right? And it's pervasive. Like once it gets going, it goes, and then a whole bunch of animals and bees and things are feeding off of that alfalfa. So one of the big concerns about genetically modified alfalfa is that it interferes with organic certification. Because then you start worrying like, well, did the GM alfalfa creep into this field and then contaminate this?
The organic people have to
sue somebody? So this is why, yeah, no, but this is...
The US would do it, you know?
Yeah.
If you're interfering with something you're trying to do and I'm
making
my sales...
Absolutely. Yeah, and this is a big difference. There's a lot more legal action that happens in the States. There's a whole different system there, right? There's a lot more money floating around, and there's a lot more legal action happening in Canada. It's slightly different. I mean, there was certainly a big outpouring of disgust against GM alfalfa from organic farmers, from customers of this store, from lots of the dairy farmers. The organic dairy farmers, all these people, right, that are invested in this system, go, hey, this is going to mess with us.
So it's approved, but has it grown? Is it growing?
In the spring, a very small amount was planted. Yes.
It's invasive, so.
Well, we know what type of potatoes, like we know the apples. Will we know what type of potatoes are going to be?
So that's a good question, and that's another reason I'm going to put a plug in for that October 13th lecture, because Lucy from CBAN is going to be discussing the latest up-to-date news on all of these approved GM products, so that you can ask her those specific things. So the core components of the non-GMO project are testing for those risk ingredients, segregation, and traceability. So similar process, but narrow focus on the genetic modification. Where's my, oh, hey, look at that. The printer didn't print the last few slides. So this just gives you sort of an example. So they're testing at every stage. So they're not just sort of going like, okay, we tested it in the field, and now we trust that by the time that corn got to your cereal, it's still non-GMO. They're tracing it at every point. So they're saying, then it went to this processing plant, right? And it was not contaminated by anything. And then it went and got packaged here, and it wasn't contaminated by anything. So they are tracing every point. So both these logos are awesome. Both of them are building... towards a non-GMO food supply, right? They're supporting that non-GMO effort. They're just doing it in different ways. So So it's important to keep in mind that the organic label is a bit more comprehensive because it covers genetic modification, but it also covers a whole host of other things, right? So we want to remember that when we see that logo, we still have to think a second. We still have to look at those ingredients and go, well, are those organic potatoes? Do they have to be?
No,
they have to be non-GMO. So does that, canola oil. But it doesn't have to be organic. So are those potatoes being sprayed?
And potatoes are really, really, really.
Yeah, maybe they're being sprayed.
Could be. You have to look into that company. You have to ask them those questions. So when you're buying organic, it's not just about buying quality products. It's about supporting that whole system. So going way back to all those first slides about soil health, about caring for those animals, making sure they have access to outdoors, biodiversity, so supporting all that ecosystem around the farm, water quality, transparency of that system. So there's a whole ton of things that you're supporting when you support that organic label. But the good news is that more and more, and this is again where that whole social movement aspect comes in, right? So that demand is increasing. So more and more companies are going like, well, hey, people really value this butterfly logo, so I'm gonna slap that on too. I'm gonna get certified by both. And that's a lot of investment. So it's really amazing that so many products are coming up with both of these labels. So they are saying to you, we are certified to the organic standard. We also care a whole lot about genetic modification and avoiding it. And so we are supporting the non-GMO project and what it represents and stands for, right? So it doesn't have to be an either or. You can buy products that are covering all their bases. Okay, how are we doing for time? Oh, look at that. All your good questions. Oh no. Okay, remember all the amazing things that were said. And now, so I just want to go over quickly. So we go on and on about how amazing the organic system is, right? It's out there, it's available. Sometimes it costs more. So we're going to chat about why that is and then some strategies to watch your budget. So why is organic more expensive? All the things we talked about today are very labor intensive. All that, hand weeding, figuring out, okay, I'm gonna introduce this in so that this bug doesn't show up on my potatoes. I'm gonna come up with creative solutions so that I'm not just spraying everything with Roundup Ready, or Roundup. A lot of organic farms are smaller, right? So that also contributes to higher production costs and getting that logo, that all those inspections cost money, right? There's less infrastructure in organic and less subsidies too. So this is a big movement that's happening now as well, where people are talking to political representatives and saying, hey, let's support this system at the very beginning. Let's support those farmers and give them subsidies so that they can make their farm organic, right? Because that takes the transitioning takes a lot too. So if somebody is growing conventional crops and then they say, hey, we really want to transition over to organic production, that requires several years and several steps to become eligible for that organic standard. Yeah.
What could you mention steps? What's the steps between conventional and turning into organic? Like, let's say this table is the field. So if we're growing conventional stuff,
yeah.
What kind of steps do they need to do in order to certify
organic? Yeah. So the biggest one is that they have to have a certain period of like fallow land. So there's nothing's growing. So that there's that transition time. I think it's 3 years.
3 years.
So it's quite a commitment. And then there would be things like if, for example, they were producing pigs or cows, maybe part of the transition would be, okay, I have to find a source of organic corn because I'm feeding my pigs corn and right now I can't find it organically. I'm using conventional, GM corn. So maybe they'd have to figure out a way to connect to an organic supplier. A big thing with the feed is the organic mills. So it's not just about growing organic seed, it's also where that seed is processed. So somebody might do an amazing job not spraying their corn, growing it organically, all of that's great, and then they only have one processing mill, and that mill is getting everybody's corn. So then you've got all sorts of contamination happening, and now that organic corn isn't considered organic anymore. So there's a lot of little things that have to get figured out to transition, and this costs money, right? So that's why these subsidies are important.
Mm-hmm. Where they all, at the end of all the grains for their feed, some of them are GMO farmers.
Yeah.
Some are not, but they put
all them together. Yeah, it's all pooled.
And
yeah.
They pool it.
Yeah.
So
same with milk.
Yeah. Pool-wise, thinking it's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Same with it's the same with a lot of dairy, right?
Okay.
It's the same with dairy that milk gets pooled in Ontario.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if it's an organic certified milk. Then that's been processed separately. But if it's another,
you should have two of them, one for organic, one.
Yeah, exactly. So that's where that infrastructure point comes in,
like
right? That. You have to build the infrastructure to support this system. So we like to say you can pay for your health now or later,
yeah,
right?
That's very true.
Okay, so there is a reason that organic products can cost more. So now how do we maximize our organic budget? So we've all thought about it, we want to support this system, but how do we do it on our budget? One of the sort of simplest and also most complicated things for a lot of people is just cooking from scratch. So get your shopping list, plan out your meals, give a little thought to it, right, so that you're not just doing grab and go all the time, and that's a really good way to pinch your pennies. Eating seasonally is a big one too. So, when you see those bushels of basil and tomato, grabbing them, making tomato sauce, canning them, or just, really enjoying your berries, like your strawberries in the summer, eating a ton of them and then going, okay, I'm not doing this again until next summer, right? Instead of trying to, because if you're going and you're buying, for example, organic strawberries all year round, they are going to get more expensive at a certain point, right? Because they've had to come in from somewhere else. Yeah. And so a really cool way to connect with that seasonal produce is using CSA and food boxes. So some of you have probably heard of things like Front Organics, Mama Earth. You might see their trucks driving around the city. Maybe your neighbor has a plastic bin on their porch once a week. So what these farms are doing is that you pay them in the spring. So you say, hey, I'm investing in you. Here's some money. And then they say, all right, now all season we're going to provide you. And there's differences between the companies. So some of them you can pick and choose what you want. Some of them will just give you sort of what's abundant in that week. So that can be a really great way to get creative too, because you might get a squash that you had never seen before, or you might get extra kale one week and go, okay, how am I gonna process this extra kale that I wouldn't normally buy? So this can be a fun way to support local and organic. And then, of course, I'm sure you've heard this before. Picking a few days a week or doing Meatless Monday or whatever, beans, grains, nuts and seeds, all those great vegetarian protein sources do tend to be less expensive. And they are available in bulk as well a lot of the time. So that's a nice way to save a bit of money. When you do want to eat meat, you want to buy the higher quality stuff, right? So you want to avoid those antibiotics and hormones, right? I always say, why are you going in and spending, $50 in the supplement store, getting all sorts of, pills for liver processing and hormone balance and whatever, and then going and buying your chicken that's full of hormones, right? So you want to support at every stage, right? So maybe you don't go and buy all those expensive supplements. You just buy the really good quality meat and know that you're feeding your body, really great nutrients. And there are ways to get creative with the meat too. So you can buy in bulk. Sometimes you can buy directly from a farmer. Sometimes people will go in and like buy a half a cow and split it up, between them.
But another thing about organic food, I want to add to something.
Mm-hmm.
is a lot of people say, oh, you buy organic food, it's more expensive.
Yeah.
They're always worried about the price. But what I always tell people is, when you buy organic food, nutrient-rich food, you don't need to eat as much. You're satisfied.
Yep.
So you're not hungry. When you're eating conventional food, you're not getting any nutrients.
Yeah.
You're hungry all the time.
Yeah.
So you're going to spend more money on food anyway.
Absolutely.
Health, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I always like to talk about it's bigger picture, right? You have to think holistically.
Yeah.
So as a nutritionist, I often come back to the basics of eat whole foods, right? So if you are comparing a diet, like if you are walking down, you know, the aisle in a Loblaws and you're comparing the organic cracker to the conventional cracker and the organic mac and cheese to the conventional mac and cheese and you're comparing all of these processed foods,
yes,
you are going to notice a difference in price. But you don't have to buy those processed foods, right? I always tell people, go on the outside aisles, right? And just get back to the basics of fruits, veg, you know,
yeah,
beans, grains, good quality meat,
yeah,
and that's a good way to cut costs as well, right?
Yeah.
Is it? But it is nice to know when you want to splurge, when you want, you know, the corn chips and salsa or whatever, that you have options and that you can, you know, you can trust in those labels. Coupons are another great way. We've got our points cards now. We've got our monthly specials. So, you know, jumping on all of those. I'm talking about the expensive organic strawberries. It is perhaps worth prioritizing those strawberries because they are on the Dirty Dozen list. So how many of you have heard of the Dirty Dozen? Yeah, pretty much everybody. That's awesome. So the Environmental Working Group produces this list every year. So they update it and they look at what is most heavily sprayed. So you can print this out, you can throw it in your wallet, you could, you know, slap it up on your fridge. And what that means is, okay, maybe I'm buying my strawberries and apples organically, but I'm just gonna get a regular old cabbage this week because I, you know, I wanna save. Or, you know, I'm not gonna worry so much about my cauliflower, but I'm gonna worry a whole ton about my celery because it's heavily sprayed, or, you know, whatever, take your pick. So it's good to know that you you have options and there are chances to prioritize if you can't afford to.
It has to do with spray.
Yes, this is particularly pesticide.
But papayas are on the clean side?
So the Clean 15, they are considering these low sprayed. So these are not crops that tend to need a ton of pesticides and insecticides and. Yeah, I mean, that's a whole other issue.
These are fruits.
Yeah, it's a whole other issue. But yeah, they're specifically looking at, like, in the average growing cycle, you know, of an apple, if you don't spray it with a whole ton of things, you're going to have a lot of problems. You're going to have a lot of worms. You're going to have a lot of, you know, bugs interfering with that. So they tend to get sprayed a lot. So then that apple might be worth buying organic so that you know that it hasn't been sprayed with. Does that make sense? And again, as I mentioned earlier, you know, voting with our dollars, being informed. So again, know the difference to make a difference, right? And you are allowed to prioritize, you know, based on your interests and what's important to you, right? So understanding what these labels mean is the first step. And then once you understand what a label means, then you can make your choices accordingly. So, you know, maybe you can't afford to buy absolutely everything with that organic logo on it, but when it comes to picking your potato chips, you're going to go with the butterfly as opposed to no label. Or, you know, things like coffee and tea and chocolate, you're really going to pay attention to that fair trade logo because those tend to be, those specific commodities are a real issue in that regard. But maybe, you know, you don't always get your organic chocolate. Hopefully you're getting both, you know, hopefully you're able to support all of these great initiatives, but it's nice to know at least what the labels mean so that you understand the choices that you're making.
So does fair trade mean it is organic?
No.
No.
You should be able to answer that after this presentation. All right, so we do have a few more minutes for questions. I hope that you...